Well, just over 3 weeks ago, Esther McVey quit her job in the Cabinet over Theresa May's Brexit plan. In her resignation letter, she said the deal does not honour the result of the referendum and fails to secure the right outcome for the future of our country. And she joins us now for her first TV interview since leaving government. Esther, welcome.
Morning.
It feels as if we've heard everybody else's account of what happened in that crucial Cabinet meeting where Theresa May's Brexit plan was signed off, apart from yours. So, what did happen?
Well, obviously, I'm not going to breach confidences of what happens in Cabinet. I never have and I won't start now, but I can put some of the record straight that has already been in the paper. Fundamentally, at the end, after we'd all been discussing for 5 hours about the Brexit deal, there were voices of dissent, people saying different things. So I asked on the most crucial issue of a generation, could we have a vote of the Cabinet to see exactly where the various secretaries of state were, where the Cabinet ministers were on the issue. It's happened before under previous administrations, so you could have a vote, but obviously it's down to the Prime Minister. It is her Cabinet. She can choose to elect what she does. But as I said, there were various voices of dissent, and I felt we needed to focus the mind of people who were taking a decision that would last longer than us being in Cabinet, longer than us being in Parliament, but was about the future of the United Kingdom.
So you didn't cry then?
No.
Why do you think people are so obsessed with whether female politicians cried?
I wonder whether it was obviously briefed to the papers afterwards, and obviously, maybe they thought that would see me in a negative light. But people who know me know that I'm forthright, I am feisty, I am straight talking, and quite rightly, I'm passionate about this issue. But all we needed to know was, what do people think? And in all honesty, I think it says there was a meltdown in the Cabinet. The meltdown was from the others not wanting to put their name next to a vote. It certainly wasn't from me asking for one.
Yeah, I'm keen to kind of talk about this because it does feel as if some of the briefings were pretty unusual, shall we say, around you. According to reports in the press, your behaviour was described as hysterical and aggressive. As you say, people said you had a meltdown. In October, an unnamed Treasury source said of you, the only thing she knows how to do well is a blow dryer. Is it sexist, do you think?
Well, look, different people use the media in different ways to portray a story and to get an issue out there. There was two things that I wanted to deliver, and that was A, Brexit, that the UK voted for, but unfortunately in the Cabinet, the majority of people and those in the key posts all voted Remain, from the Prime Minister to the Chancellor to the Deputy Prime Minister to the Home Secretary to the Foreign Secretary. So, obviously, there's obviously an issue there. And the other thing that I wanted to do was get more money for universal credit, because, yes, it does a heck of a lot of good, but for the most vulnerable, it wasn't supporting. So I succeeded in getting in the budget £4.5 billion extra. And again, at the time, everybody didn't want that to happen either. So that could be why you've had briefings, because it was on two issues, more money for universal credit and two, to deliver the Brexit vote that the people of the UK put forward.
OK, should we deal with universal credit? Because it feels as if there's been a lot written about it. People's feelings run very, very strongly about universal credit. And I know that that was something that, of course, you were responsible for up to your resignation. Now, according to the Trussell Trust, they say on average 12 months after universal credit is rolled out, food banks see a 52% increase in demand. 70% of recipients find themselves in debt while waiting for their payments, and only 8% say that payment covers their cost of living. I mean, is that a record you're proud of?
Well, the Trussell Trust there, you've got to look at where the source is coming from, who have been interviewed to give those comments, and that's from people coming into the Trussell Trust. So those results weren't authenticated. They weren't sort of verified as such.
But it's no secret that people were in hardship when they had to wait for those payments to come through.
What I will say is, and that's what I spent 8 months doing, saying, OK, how do we sort out one sort of extreme of people saying it isn't working at all to other people who are saying it's the best thing that ever happened. So for 85% of people or more, they are saying it's helping us into work. We're working more than ever before, which we've seen. 1,000 people every day, each and every day since 2010, are in work, so it's working there. But what I looked at is, but for the people it's not working for, so those are the people who will find themselves going into the Trussell Trust. Those are people who'll find themselves going to support groups and budget groups, Christians Against Poverty, CAB, various other institutions. So I met with all them and said, what can we do? Hence, I fought for the extra £4.5 billion in the budget. Hence, I fought for £1.5 billion to make sure that the severe disability premium was there for 500,000 extra people. So I said, how do we make it work? What money needs to come forward? But not just money, it was about how it was delivered to. So people would say, how can we make sure that the payment period and the assessment period doesn't knock out our payment? How do we make sure that we get money straight away, which you can get with an advance? And going forward, how do we make sure it's not always paid monthly? It could be paid weekly, fortnightly, three-weekly, four-weekly. So a lot of that I've already put in place. Some of it will be coming through after the vote in the House. And then further monies are coming forward next year, and that's on delivery. So I said we've got to have outreach work, we've got to have a flexible fund, we've got to look at those people who you will be hearing for, which it doesn't work for at the moment. So a good government, a proper government, and how this system was set up was to be about, it's about being agile, it's about being able to quickly respond to people's needs. And that's what we needed to do, and that's what we are doing and should continue to do as a compassionate Conservative government. And again, I said, how can you give £39 billion to the EU, and for what for? And yet I'm fighting desperately for few billion for the most vulnerable people in the UK. That cannot be right.
Now that you're not in government anymore and you don't have to defend universal credit, are you sorry for any of the hardships that some people faced?
What I will say, and I think you've got to look at it in its entirety, the legacy system it replaced wasn't working. So people who could have got out of poverty and into work, it wasn't working for them. They couldn't work more than 16 hours, 24 hours, 30 hours. So they were trapped in poverty. This, for the first time ever, makes work pays. It allows people to come forward and come out of poverty. So again, thousands, 3.5 million more people we've helped.
Okay.
But those who it wasn't working for, we knew we've got to make it do better. And equally, under Labour, the benefits bill shot up by 60%. They'd made the benefit system unaffordable and unsustainable going forward. I've always said we took difficult decisions in 2010 and 2015 to make it affordable. But you know what? As we come out of austerity, as we want to make this work, that's what we've got to do. We've now got to look at the freeze on benefits. Do we still need that? Maybe not. Remove that and mixed-age couples in the new year. How do we support them?
OK. Let's look forward to next week now, because this vote on Tuesday, if it happens, is going to be absolutely crucial. A lot of MPs are saying that they can't support the Prime Minister's deal. If it gets voted down, as we expect it will, what do you think needs to happen then?
The Prime Minister immediately has to go to the EU and get a better deal. That's what she must do. And there are two key things. People talk about the 585-page document. There are two key things in there. One is the backstop. We don't need the backstop. We shouldn't have the backstop. The EU says it doesn't want it. We don't want it. So why is it there? Remove it.
But at the same time, I mean, you can say that, you know, no one wants to be in a traffic jam, so why should there be a traffic jam? The same, you know, the reason that there's a backstop is to avoid that border
in Ireland. I don't think that's the same thing. A traffic jam is there. No, we are creating the backstop. It isn't there. Therefore, nobody wants it. Remove it. And the other bit is the £39 billion. Why, oh, why are we handing over £39 billion and what for? That £39 billion shouldn't be for the withdrawal agreement moving out. That £39 billion has to be used for the future agreement. That has to be for our future trade agreement with them. And if that isn't happening, we cannot agree to this withdrawal.
If Theresa May cannot get what you want her to, what should she do? Should she move to a second referendum? Should she call an election? Or do you think she should then move to a managed no deal?
Well, what she said, and I've agreed with her since she started, we've got to come out the customs union, we've got to come out the single market.
So Norway's not an option for you?
No. We've got to have control of our laws, of our borders, of our money, of our sovereignty, of movement of people. And therefore, she has got to say, as she's always said, no deal is better than a bad deal. That's what we said, that's what we agreed in. Article 50 is there, and we are coming out of the EU, as she replied to me in a Prime Minister's questions, we are coming out on the 29th of March.
So therefore, no deal is better than the deal on the table, is what you're saying?
We've always said, if we cannot come to an agreement, then we will be coming out without one. So we've always said no deal was better than a bad deal. Not Remain. Remain was never there, and the people voted for out. So what she's got to say, because the EU doesn't want no deal, we don't want no deal. So between us, of course, we can get a better deal for the UK. Backstop goes. The £39 billion is for our future agreement. Not to talk about an agreement. Who'd pay £39 billion to talk about an agreement? £39 billion is for that agreement.
At the same time, though, there's been some pretty concerning warnings about the impact of no deal. And I know there's a lot of scepticism about some of the forecasts, but it does feel as if there is perhaps a unanimous recognition that there will be an economic hit if there is no deal. Is that a price worth paying?
We've heard Project Fear 1 when we heard all of these. And coming back to my department, we got told if we even voted for the referendum, 500,000 more people would be unemployed. That did not happen. We've still got record rates of employment. In fact, the UK has created, since 2010, more jobs than France, Spain, Ireland, Austria, Sweden, the Netherlands and Norway put together. So I've heard the Project Fear stories, and this is yet more. Of course we can succeed, and of course we want to make sure that it is a managed process. So if there is no deal, we would have, as we've got now, an implementation period by which we would work together. We could even say, here's half the money up front, and then half
the money
at the end.
But if there's no deal, there isn't an implementation period.
No, but why not? Of course you could arrange to have one, because you pay for the implementation period, about £10 billion. That is not true. If you've got an implementation for a deal, you would negotiate to have an implementation for no deal, because we pay for that implementation period. And of course, if the EU don't want no deal, we don't want no deal. What we both want is to be good neighbours, good allies, good friends. We are in the same geography. So let's get that free trade agreement. I believe it is there to get.
The other people who don't want no deal is UK MPs. Are you not concerned that because there is such a majority in the House against a no deal scenario, that by voting down the Prime Minister's deal, all you're doing is making a second referendum more likely and no Brexit at all?
Look, MPs come to Parliament because the people elected them. Now, in Parliament, by a vast majority, we said the people should have a say. We gave the referendum to the people to have a say. They told us it was either in or out, and they said out. Now, that's what the people said. Unfortunately, in the House, there's too many MPs who voted Remain, so they are going against the people. So when you talk about trust, trust in Parliament, trust in government, that's what it's about. They've said, you asked us, we've given you our decision, now go and do that. Don't try and confuse us. And in fact, this is something that I heard at the weekend when I was meeting with my constituents. They said, you know what, Est? When people can't convince people, they try and confuse people, and that's what we feel politicians are doing to us now. We don't want you to confuse us. We know we can get a better deal. What are we paying for? Nobody wants this backstop. Give us what we ask for, which is Brexit, which is to come out of the EU.
You said just then that too many MPs backed Remain. You were talking earlier about the number of Remain supporters in the Cabinet. Do you think the next leader of the Conservative Party needs to be a Brexiteer?
I think that, first of all, we've got to take one step at a time. And if, and I'm led to believe today, that the Prime Minister's going to go and have another go at negotiating with the EU, which she wasn't prepared to do, which I asked her to do in Cabinet, she wasn't prepared to. But if she goes out and gets this deal that we want on those two key points, well, then she will remain as our Prime Minister because she will have done the deal that she was asked to do. And if she doesn't, then it is going to be very difficult for her. But fundamentally, what she needs to understand...
Does she need to resign if she can't get the deal that you want?
Let's take... It's not what I want, it's what the public wants, what we voted for. In and out was on that ballot sheet, and the country voted
out. Well, it's difficult to know exactly what everybody voted for, isn't it?
No, it isn't.
People voted for different reasons.
Because... We always said we're coming out of the customs union, we're coming out of the single market. We will be in control of our borders, our laws, our money, our sovereignty. So people knew what that was. The Prime Minister has said that for the last 2 years. In Parliament, she said that for 2 years. So we all knew what it was. And obviously, there was a significant debate beforehand and people knew what it was for. And that's what we've got to do because it is about... How do we get, which John was talking about before, the division in the country? People are saying, look, I feel not only let down by our parliament and our MPs who give us a referendum and defer choice to us and what we should be doing, or they defer choice upwards to another greater authority, the EU. What are our elected MPs doing? They need to be making our decisions, and with that, making domestic decisions. So we want more money for the police. We want more police on the street. 39 billion. Wouldn't that be better being spent at home as well as getting a better deal? And also a trading deficit of £100 billion with the EU that has grown over the time that we've been in the EU. No, let's strike free trade deals around the world. Okay. That now, as the EU admits, 90% of future growth is outside the EU, not inside. We are an outward-looking global nation. We've been traders with the globe. That's what we need to do.
And just finally, just to end on the leadership point, if Theresa May fails to get her deal through, if she can't get what you want her to get from Brussels, would you consider putting in a letter of no confidence?
Well, I stood down from the government because I didn't have confidence in what it was doing. So I've done that because I didn't have confidence in where it was going and what it was doing. However, if the Prime Minister goes back to the EU, like she's saying now, and gets a better deal, something she was not prepared to do when I asked her in Cabinet, if she is, then I am fully behind her if she can get a better deal.
Would you ever want to lead yourself?
At the moment, I am looking for a person who can unite the party behind a Brexit deal, a person who believes in Brexit, who's got really the full passion to deliver.
Can you see someone who's doing that?
Well, I've seen the array of people who've come forward at the moment, and I think if we can all get behind one, for me, the most important thing is not the personalities, it is the deal for our country.
So you're not ruling
to make
it out,
better.
You're not ruling out running for the leadership?
If people asked me, then of course you'd say, of course you'd give it serious concern and do it if people asked me. But at the moment, I'm looking at who's in the papers, who can we get behind. But it shouldn't be about the personality. It should be about the country and this deal.